Hello people, in this video let us look at top priority questions from ophthalmology. First let us look at section 1, in which we are looking at aphakia, very important, myopia, hypermetropia, presbyopia. These three refract these two are refractive errors, this is accommodative error. These three important, LASIK important. Let us look at these in slight detail. So aphakia means what? Absent lens. In aphakia, what and all will be there, we have already seen in this video. Crystalline lens is absent from the pupillary area of the eye, right? So it can cause hypermetropia. So why will there be no lens? Because of the congenitally it can be absent, or surgically they could have removed it because of cataract or something. So here the person will have hypermetropia. What else you should know here? These people will have black pupil, jet black pupil, isn't it? Pupil is jet black, then Purkinje images, only two will be there because lens will be forming two and cornea will be forming two. Because lens is not there now, only two Purkinje images you will have, right? Then fundus examination, what will you see? Very similarly, like in hypermetropia, you will see hypermetropic small disc, okay? Something to do with blue and red light is there, erythropsia, synopsia, read about that, okay? That is all in aphakia. Treatment, how you will, what will you do? You will give them an intraocular lens, isn't it? Artificial lens, pseudophakia they will become then. So basically why we don't give them spectacles? Because they will have all this jack in the box phenomena, like what is that called as? Scotoma, roving ring scotoma, right? Next is myopia, guys. Myopia means basically the image will be forming in front of the retina. So you have axial myopia, curvatural myopia, positional myopia, index myopia. So many myopias are there. Myopia due to excessive accommodation. So grading less than minus 3 diopters is low. So you have congenital, then you have simple developmental school myopia, pathologic myopia, acquired or secondary myopia because trauma or drug. Okay, so then what have we seen in congenital, simple, pathological? What else is there? Prevention of myopia, avoid excessive near work. How will you treat myopia, guys? Concave lens, remember, concave lens, okay? Concave lens is the word they'll be looking for. Surgical treatment, you have laser. What is there in laser? PRK and LASIK. PRK, what do they do? In PRK, there will be no flap, isn't it? LASIK, they will create a flap and then they will do cornea, they will adjust the corneal curvature and then close the flap, right? You should know the full form, guys. PRK is photorefractive keratectomy. LASIK is laser in situ keratomeliusis. Coming to hypermetropia, guys, the image is forming behind the retina. Here you have, it is also called as far or long sightedness, but that is not correct term, right? So this is a refractive error. Here the parallel rays which are coming from distant object are forming behind the retina when the accommodation is at rest. This is what you have to remember as the definition. So babies are hypermetropic, plus 2 to plus 3 they are at birth, and then they become emetropic around 5 to 7 years, and till 50 years they will be this, okay? What else? Grading of hypermetropia, less than plus 2 diopter is low. Clinical features, these people will be asymptomatic or they will have asthenopic symptoms, that is eye strain, eye tiredness, right? They can have defective vision with these symptoms or defective vision only, all that you will write. Signs, what will you see in this? They'll have a small eyeball, right? Guys, are you focused? What are we looking at? Hypermetropia. Very good. So, what will you see? Small eyeball, cornea will be small, anterior chamber is shallow. They have refractive error, hypermetropic refractive error. Fundus will show pseudopapillitis, short silk appearance. Okay, these two words you have to remember. Then, what are the causes? Same axial, curvatural, index positional, aphakia can cause hypermetropia. Then, clinical types you have, congenital, acquired, functional. Simple and non-physiological or pathological. So you have pathological in both myopia, hypermetropia. Components, you have total, latent, manifest. In under manifest, again, you have facultative, absolute. Okay. Complications of hypermetropia, blepharitis, squint, amblyopia, primary narrow angle glaucoma. Remember, narrow angle glaucoma comes in hypermetropia. In myopia, you will see what? Open angle glaucoma, because myopics will have big eyeball, but these hypermetropics have small eyeball. What will the treatment? Remember, convex lens, you have to write this convex, 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 convex for hypermetropia. Treatment, same thing again, you have PRK, photorefractive keratectomy, that is hyperopic PRK, you have to write here, hyperopic LASIK, you should write here. Okay, just remember these two, hyperopic, hyperopic. same thing like myopia. Then if it is aphakia, that is you fix the aphakia, you give pseudophakia. That's it. Okay. Next is presbyopia. So we are done with aphakia, myopia, hypermetropia. Now let's move on to presbyopia. So this is accommodation error. So here what happens as the person turns 40, the accommodation is reducing. So he's not able to see near things, but he can see far things, remember. So here almost everything is there in this slide only looks like. So how will you correct? Correct it with the convex lens. That's it. So he has decrease in the amplitude of accommodation. Amplitude of accommodation. So there are some technical things here, looks like. So age at 40 is equal to 14 diopters. Similarly, age is equal to 100 by 25 minus 1 by infinity, 4 diopters. The glasses that they prescribe for presbyopics can be unifocal, bifocal, trifocal, multifocal, varifocal, progressive lens. Okay. So everything is, these are very difficult to manage. Unifocal is good actually. Corneal surgeries, you have again surgeries for presbyopia. They're treating the cornea, looks like. Wow. Interesting. Okay. There is presbyopic, bifocal, LASIK. Interesting. So in presbyopia, guys, there's some term here, increasing punctum proximum. What is this? Increasing punctum proximum. The near point is increasing. Guys, now let us look at what is important in conjunctiva. In conjunctiva, very important are these pterygium, fly tenular conjunctivitis, ophthalmia neonatorum, and spring catarrh. Let us look at these. So first, let us start it with the spring catarrh. It comes under allergic conjunctivitis. So this is basically a bilateral self-limiting condition. There is some TH2 lymphocyte alteration. You should know this, TH2 lymphocyte alteration. It affects boys more. Okay, exaggerated IgE response. Then what else is there in this? Clinical features will be marked burning, itching sensation, photophobia, lacrimation. So there is palpebral form and bulbar form. In palpebral form, you will see this cobblestone, pavement stone fashion. Then in bulbar limbal form, you will see Horner Tranta spot, collection of eosinophils, right triangular congestion, right? Corneal involvement, even cornea can be involved. See, now we are actually reading conjunctivitis. Now cornea can get involved. You can have punctate epithelial keratitis, ulcerative vernal keratitis, shield ulceration, vernal corneal plaques, subepithelial scarring, ring scar, pseudogerontoxin. All these you will see. Differential, you should be able to differentiate it from trachoma. Treatment, how will you give? This is anyways an allergic reaction, so you just give mast cell stabilizers, antihistamine, steroids, etc. Okay, so otherwise they are talking, if the it is very, if the papillae are very huge, then you can go supratarsal injection, cryo application, surgical excision of those large papillae. Okay, so how will you treat if there is corneal problem? They have to increase steroids, looks like. Shield ulcer, therapeutic keratectomy, surgical excision of large vernal plaque, superficial keratectomy. Okay, so all this they have told in vernal keratoconjunctivitis. This is a very, very important topic. Then ophthalmia neonatorum is important. So understand that this ophthalmia neonatorum can be acute or chronic. So basically you should know the incubation period for different things. If it is chemical cause, then 6 hours. If it's gonococcal because of Neisseria gonorrhoeae, 4 days. Four, remember, for gonorrhea, 4 days. Other bacterial can be 5 days. Herpes, 15 days. Neonatal inclusion conjunctivitis, 21 days. So why does virus take so long? 15 days. And the neonatal inclusion conjunctivitis, this is again bacteria, 21 days. Okay. So this is ophthalmia neonatorum. You should be able to write this if they ask. Okay. Then coming to fly tenular, okay, conjunctivitis, this is also allergic. This is because of the endogenous allergens, right? Endogenous antigen, isn't that the cause? Yes, guys, you can say endogenous allergens. Okay, so delayed hypersensitivity to tuberculous proteins, staphylococcus proteins, worms, right? All those they have written, worms infestation, etc. Okay, here what and all you should say: nodule formation, ulceration, granulation, healing. So there can be mild discomfort in the eye, irritation, reflex watering, right? All that you will write standard for conjunctivitis, nothing. Guys, focus. What is this photo here? They are seeing some fascicular corneal ulcer diagrammatic clinical photograph. Corneal ulcer is there. What is this? So they have so many ulcers here. Sacrophilous ulcer, fascicular ulcer, miliary ulcer, diffuse infiltrative like tenular keratitis vascularization, rich vascularization all around the limbus. Then, how will you manage this condition? You know that it is some delayed hypersensitivity to some endogenous allergens. So they are giving topical steroids here, they are giving antibiotics, etc. Atropine if cornea is involved, right? How will atropine help if cornea is involved, guys? What do you think? Because atropine usually reduces the ciliary spasm and it reduces pain. But if a cornea is involved, cornea is also very, is going to create a lot of pain. But how will atropine help if cornea is involved? What do you think? Then coming to specific therapy, if you know it is because of tuberculosis, you find out if it's tuberculosis, then you can treat that. Septic focus, parasitic infestations means you will want deworming. Okay. General measures, vitamin A, C, D. Shall we move to pterygium, guys? So this is pterygium. So this is wing-like. And if this having blood vessels, then it is progressive, isn't it? Progressive pterygium. So it can affect vision if it starts encroaching on the pupillary area. This pterygium has some parts, head, cap, neck, all that if you remember. Let's check with. It's a degenerative condition of the conjunctiva, wing-shaped fold, then so it will start encroaching and it will destroy what and all looks like. Superficial stroma, Bowman's layer, corneal epithelium. So you have three types of pterygium. Stationary, it's not at all progressing, but then it starts progressive, then regressive. Regressive will be very thin, you can look at this. So you should remember the Stalker's line, ion deposit, deposit of ion, right? This is important, Stalker's line in regressive, okay? Complications, there can be neoplastic change to epithelioma, so that just got dangerous. Malignant melanoma, fibrosarcoma, it can become any of these. Okay. Differential diagnosis between pterygium and pseudopterygium. Pseudopterygium, you can pass the probe, looks like, okay. So you can pass the probe. Where have they written that? Probe can be passed in pseudopterygium. In pseudopterygium, you can pass the probe. Pseudopterygium usually will be because of burns, chemical burns. Treatment, you will do surgical excision, and remember, very important, you have to do this autograft. They are giving mitomycin, so all this to prevent recurrence, right? This is important. Surgical excision with amniotic membrane graft, this is another interesting thing. So amniotic membrane graft, mitomycin, all these are important. That is, these are the steps how to excise them. That's it. Then let's move back to, so we're done with conjunctiva, let's move to cornea now. Guys, in cornea, keratoplasty is important. Hypopyon, corneal ulcer, fungal corneal ulcer, herpes simplex, keratitis, corneal signs, acanthamoeba. Layers of the cornea is important. Organisms which can penetrate intact corneal epithelium, penetrating keratoplasty. So all these are important. When it comes to the layers of cornea, you have the epithelium, endothelium, middle you have stroma, behind the epithelium you have Bowman's membrane, behind the, in front of the endothelium you have the Descemet's membrane and the Douwes layer. So these are the layers. Then let's move on to the next important one. Hypopyon corneal ulcer means ulcus serpens. Okay. So here you are able to see pus and anterior chamber. It is called hypopyon corneal ulcer if it is because of pneumococcus. This is all you have to know. Otherwise, hypopyon can be caused because of many, many reasons. If it is because of pneumococcus, you will say hypopyon corneal ulcer or ulcus serpens. Okay. What is pseudohypopyon? If it is because of tumor cells, like in retinoblastoma, if the tumor cells are deposited in the anterior chamber, they can cause a pseudohypopyon. And usually this pneumococcus, from where will it come in hypopyon corneal ulcer, that is ulcus serpens, from where will this pneumococcus come? From the chronic dacryocystitis, from the lacrimal sac, which is inflamed chronically. As this hypopyon will be bacterial will be able to move, right? The hypopyon will move as you tilt the head. And also bacterial will be it will be sterile. The bacteria will not be exactly there in the hypopyon. Acanthamoeba keratitis. What is acanthamoeba? It's a protozoa, right? Okay. Fungal can cause, virus can cause corneal ulcer. So you have to know all of these. Let's go to fungal corneal ulcer. Fungal corneal ulcer, mycotic corneal ulcer, fungal keratitis. All these names are there. Because it is because of fungi, especially people are abusing antibiotics and steroids. That time this will happen. The symbiosis between between the bacteria and the fungi will go off, and then the fungi which were there, they themselves become pathogens. So whom and all you should remember here, just remember three names: Aspergillus, Fusarium, Candida. These three main you should know. Aspergillus most common, and all the how will you check and all that KOH mount, lactose, cotton, phenol blue and all that you will write. Right, for lab diagnosis. Then how will the person get, because of vegetative matter, animal tail, if they are immunosuppressed, they're taking too many steroids, right? Then what will be the symptoms? They will have very mild symptoms. They won't even know a kind of thing. Everything will be there, but very mild. They'll have a hypopyon which doesn't move, right, with the tilting of head. Then the hypopyon as such will have hyphae. That's why it will not move. So fungus will be present in the hypopyon of a in a fungal corneal ulcer. Then what else? Diagnosis we already told you. Polymerase chain reaction, right? All that. Then treatment you will give topical antifungals. Remember natamycin, which will be against Aspergillus and Fusarium. Natamycin for Aspergillus, Fusarium, Nystatin for Candida. Okay, you have to remember this. Amphotericin B, all that you write. Okay, fluconazole, voriconazole, all that you can write. Intracameral, they are saying intracameral, that is into the eye cavity. They are giving voriconazole. Systemic antifungals also they are giving for deeper fungal keratitis, like fluconazole, ketoconazole. Okay. Then, non-specific treatment, same thing. The cycloplegic drugs, give them dark goggles, vitamin A, B, C. Therapy. Finally, if it is completely damaged, they're doing corneal transplant. Then let's move on. Herpes. Herpes simplex keratitis is very important. So dendritic ulcer, if they say again, they are referring to herpes simplex keratitis. So here they are talking about herpes simplex keratitis is what, DNA virus. So mainly because of HSV1, it can be HSV1 acquired by kissing, etc. But even herpes simplex virus 2 also can, it is transmitted to the eye of the neonate from the infected genitalia of the mother. So there is primary herpes, which is the first attack. Here, the cornea epithelium is affected, stroma and all is not affected. So there can be punctate keratitis. What are we looking at? Cornea, right? We are looking at cornea. So here you should remember dendritic ulcer, etc. So how will you treat this epithelial keratitis? Acyclovir, etc. Now, in recurrent herpes, epithelium can be affected, stroma can be affected, etc., etc. can be affected. If epithelium is affected, then they are talking about dendritic ulcer, then geographic ulcer. Now, here geographic ulcer is coming. Dendritic ulcer you also saw in the primary one. Remember, you should not give steroids here, okay, in dendritic one. So, this is dendritic, and then after that, you have geographic. Now, after epithelium, what can get affected? The stroma. Under stroma, they are saying disciform keratitis, diffuse stromal necrotic keratitis, okay. Here, you have some Westley immune ring. In disciform, look at this, like disc, right? Disciform. You can give steroids here, okay? Only in dendritic ulcer, they are not giving steroids. Now, coming to diffuse stromal necrotic keratitis, here you have necrotic corneal lesions. Now, it has gone even to the other parts, like iritis, etc. Then, what do you have? Trophic keratitis. This is the third part of the recurrent herpes simplex keratitis. Trophic metaherpetic. Here, they are saying it is not an active viral disease. Then how will you treat all this they have given here? Herpetic iridocyclitis. This is the fourth part. Now from there it is going to the iris and choroid, etc. Not choroid, what is it? Ciliary body. So they are calling it as iridocyclitis. Okay, so that is about the herpes. Here, what is this? You have dendritic ulcer, right? Where do you find microdendritic in herpes zoster? What we are looking at is herpes simplex. Pseudodendrites, where will you find? Acanth amoeba keratitis, okay, in contact lens users, pseudodendrites. So these words you should not get confused. Where will you see dendritic? In herpes simplex. Where will you see microdendritic? In herpes zoster. Where will you see pseudodendrites? You will see in acanth amoeba keratitis. Okay. So these are all the antiviral drugs you should know. For herpes simplex, which you have looked at now, currently herpes simplex you looked at, idoxuridine, vidarabine, trifluorothymidine, that is TFT, acyclovir, famciclovir. Then you have, remember vidarabine, you remember, valacyclovir, etc. For CMV retinitis, they are talking about zidovudine. Okay, for cytomegalovirus, usually HIV, so zidovudine. Then non-selective, you have interferons and immunoglobulins. Now, acanth amoeba keratitis, let us look at this. Basically, acanth amoeba keratitis, it's a protozoa. Acanth amoeba, it is a protozoa, parasite it is, and it's a free living amoeba. So people, it produces what? Acanth amoeba, keratitis. In HIV people, it produces a lot of other things. Inflammations of the cornea, so keratitis, right? So it, what does it do? It is coming under ulcerative keratitis. This is the classification. So there is a mechanism of adhesion of this. So mannose binding protein on the acanth amoeba adheres to the glycoprotein receptors on the corneal epithelium. As such, this is the only technical thing that you can see here, right? So usually who people who wash their contact lens with water, and nowadays they're saying even in non-contact lens users it is coming. Mild pain to severe pain. Okay, remember that. Then what are the signs here? Difficult to diagnose it is. Same epithelial lesions are there, pseudodendrites. So we already told you, where will you see pseudodendrites? You will see it in acanth amoeba, right? Very important. Acanth amoeba, you will see pseudodendrites. Dendritic is herpes simplex. Where will you find microdendrite? Yes, that is in herpes zoster. Very good. Stromal lesions are there, radial keratoneuritis, ring infiltrates, ring abscess, satellite stromal infiltrates, limbal and scleral lesions are there, limbitis, scleritis, ring-shaped ulcer. All this you'll have to see in signs. Okay, differential diagnosis, you have to differentiate it because it is protozoa or bacterial or viral or fungal conjunctivitis, keratitis. Then coming to diagnosis here, they're taking confocal microscopy, then you will do KOH mount, lactophenol cotton blue. They're talking about PCR, yes, obviously, corneal biopsy, and they're looking for some cysts, looks like. Okay, so because this acanth amoeba, it seems to have this cyst, right? So they seem to be looking for that. Then lastly, they're talking about treatment. Treatment, propamidine is thionate. Propamidine is thionate, hexamidine, polyhexamethylene biguanide, PHMB. Where will you hear PHMB? Acanth amoeba. Can you say PHMB? Yeah, say acanth amoeba. Say polyhexa methylene biguanide. Guanide, okay, thank you. So then here they are trying to differentiate things. This is not important. So contact lens users are usually affected by Pseudomonas and then acanth amoeba. Next question is, which organisms can penetrate intact corneal epithelium? Neisseria gonorrhoeae, Neisseria meningitis, and Cornminibacterium diphtheria. Say these three. Neisseria. Can you say Neisseria? Gonorrhoeae.
Gonorrhoeae.
Neisseria meningitis.
Meningitis.
Cornminibacterium
Bacterium.
diphtheria.
Diphtheria.
Okay, thank you. So we're done with the organisms which can penetrate. Penetrating keratoplasty and keratoplasty, these two, we'll look at them now, indications. So keratoplasty is cornea transplant, guys. And here they are, this is part of cornea they're removing and putting. This is penetrating all the layers they're showing here. So they're autokeratoplasty, that they'll just turn the same person's cornea around. Allo means they will take a donor and they will do that. You have rotational keratoplasty under auto. Auto, you have rotational, and then you have contralateral keratoplasty. From the blind eye, they will take the cornea and put in the other eye if it needs. Allokeratoplasty is because patient's diseased cornea is replaced with donor's healthy cornea. When will you do penetrating, that is full thickness, or when will you do lamellar keratoplasty, that is partial thickness grafting? In lamellar, you have deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty, DALK, and you have DSEK, Desmet's stripping endothelial keratoplasty. Okay, then there is small patch graft. So DALK is where the they're changing what? Only the anterior part of it. DSEK, they are changing the endothelium. So when it got damaged, endothelium got damaged during some cataract surgery or something. So that time they are changing only that endothelium part, looks like. Why will you do a full thickness or a penetrating keratoplasty if there is a advanced keratoconus? You can remember then bullous keratopathy. Remember, bullous keratopathy is the most common indication. Then you have deep leukoma, etc., for cosmetic reasons. But you have to remember only this: bullous keratopathy, advanced keratoconus, deep corneal ulcer, and cosmetic reasons they are doing. Why would they do an anterior lamellar keratoplasty? Again, if there is an ulcer, if there's opacity, if there is some dystrophy, lattice dystrophy, they're doing that. Okay. We have looked at how to grade a donor tissue, right? Grade 1 to 5. 5 is really poor, actually. Then how to store it, Mercari-Kaufmann, Optisol, chondroitin sulfate, all these. Then surgical techniques, how to do complications of keratoplasty, graft rejection, all this we have seen. So we are done with all the cornea topics, guys. Let's move on to sclera now. Episcleritis is a very important topic, guys. So in episcleritis, we have seen that its episclera is affected with the tenon capsule. It's a dense vascularized layer, right? And it is common in women, it says. It is a hypersensitivity reaction or idiopathic. Basically, remember here, there is nothing immune. There is no autoimmune cause like scleritis. There is lymphocytic infiltration. There is simple and nodular, two types of episcleritis you should know. Simple and nodular. Simple is this one. It is, see, it's touching the limbus kind of thing. Nodular is away from the limbus. So that's what you can remember here. Nodular is away from the limbus. And this kind of resembles pingicula, so you should be careful. Clinical features, there is no pain. Remember, 10% phenylephrine will produce blanching, isn't it? And there is really no treatment required. Self-resolving it is, otherwise they are giving some NSAIDs. So you have seen the difference between episcleritis and scleritis. Episcleritis is not painful and it is bright red in color. Now let's move on to the next important topics in ophthalmology. These topics are important in uveal tract, uveitis, classify acute iridocyclitis, granulomatous uveitis, anterior, acute anterior uveitis, occlusive and secclusive, that is occlusio pupillae, acute red eye, differential diagnosis and evisceration. Let's look at this uveitis classification. Here we have seen that what uvea is, and then we have seen what uveitis is, anatomical classification, you have anterior, right, then again that you have subdivisions, then you have intermediate uveitis, posterior uveitis and you have pan uveitis. So that is the classification. Then you have acute, chronic, recurrent, etc. Then you have pathological, you have suppurative, non-suppurative, so many types of classification are there. Infective uveitis, immune related, toxic, trauma, so many types of uveitis classification. So that's the classification. Let's move on to acute iridocyclitis. Iridocyclitis, nothing but anterior uveitis, right? You can have iritis or iridocyclitis. So iridocyclitis means iris and pars plicata of are involved, and this can be idiopathic, HLA associated uveitis, pain, redness, defective vision, lacrimation, photophobia. So this is the differential diagnosis for acute red eye. So what will you see here? Keratic precipitates. So guys, here you can have keratic precipitates. Very important. You have to mention this anterior uveitis. So they'll ask you types of keratic precipitates. That itself can be a question. So there you will have to write mutton fat keratic precipitates, that is in granulomatous iridocyclitis, small and medium keratic precipitates, you have fine keratic precipitates, then you have old keratic precipitates. Four names you remember. What are the four names, guys, you will remember? Mutton fat, small, medium, fine and old. Okay, these you have to write. Okay, then let's move on. Here they are showing you festooned pupil, keratic precipitates, circumciliary congestion, segmental posterior synoche. Anterior chamber may be deep, aqueous cells, aqueous flare, hypopyon can be there. Then what else? They are talking about change in iris color, muddy, coppe nodule, busaka nodules. Coppe is near and busaka is a little far. You can see coppe is on the line, isn't it? Coppe is on the pupillary margin. Coppe is always on the pupillary margin, remember. Then you have secclusio pupil, pupillae, iris bombae, right? Then rubiosis, iridis, all this you should remember. Lot of terminologies are there. That's why they will ask this iridocyclitis. Narrow pupil meiosis, occlusio pupillae. Lens can have changes, complicated cataract, maturity, cystoid macular edema, intraocular pressure, glaucoma. How will you check iridocyclitis, hematological investigations, urine? Why are they doing all this? Non-specific treatment. Now they're coming to treatment, local therapy, systemic therapy. These are non-specific. Let's look at specific. Specific treatment, you will treat the cause. Then these are the complications that can happen if you don't treat. You can lose the eye. Okay. So granulomatous uveitis also is anterior iridocyclitis only, right? Look at the differences between granulomatous and non-granulomatous. Granulomatous is... what will you see here? Wait. Pain is minimal. Why? Because it's chronic condition. That's why he's sustained it all this long, right? So it is minimal pain, slight photophobia, minimal ciliary congestion, keratic precipitates. You have mutton fat KPs. Remember this. Mutton fat KPs you will have. Okay. Aqueous flare is mild. all this. This is all very mild, 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 mild things. Non-granulomatous, everything will be more. Remember, you will have mutton fat KPs and granulomatous, that's it. Everything else will be same only. There'll be milder forms, that's it. So we finished all these three, guys. We finished granulomatous, we finished acute anterior uveitis also we saw. Occlusive, secclusive pupillae also we saw. Acute red eye differential diagnosis, only three things you have to write. Acute conjunctivitis, acute iridocyclitis, and acute congestive glaucoma. Only three things you have to. So only three things you have to write, and you have to distinguish. See, in conjunctivitis, usually everything will be fine, okay? Except the conjunctiva will have some little mild discomfort, some discharge will be there. Other than that, everything else will be fine. Vision will be fine, etc. Now, coming to acute iridocyclitis here, how will the pupil be? Pupil will be small and irregular. Remember, it will be small and irregular, right? That is acute iridocyclitis. Everything features you just now saw. Iris will be muddy, slightly impaired vision, then deep ciliary congestion, tenderness will be there. KPs will be there. Keratic precipitates, remember, mainly, okay? Then coming to acute congestive glaucoma, here you will see large and oval pupil. So pupil is changing here. Again, here you had irregular. Here you have oval pupil. Here you will have raised intraocular pressure can be there, right? Then person can have vomiting, prostration. He can have very shallow anterior chamber. How will the vision be? Vision will be markedly impaired, okay? So all these things you can check. What is evisceration? So what is the difference between enucleation, evisceration, and exenteration? So there are three words that you should know here. Enucleation, evisceration, and exenteration. So let's put it like this. Evisceration, enucleation, and exenteration. So evisceration, where the sclera will still, you will retain the sclera, only the contents inside you will remove. Enucleation, even the sclera is removed, so only the muscles are there in the orbit, and in exenteration, nothing will be there in the orbit. Okay, so is it clear? See, exenteration, nothing is there in the orbit. In enucleation, orbit is there and muscles are there. In evisceration, muscles are there, sclera is also there. Okay, and contents inside that won't be there. Here you can see, what is this? You can see they are removing the entire sclera with the sclera. This is enucleation. Enucleation is complete excision of the eyeball with sclera. What is evisceration? Removal the content of the eyeball, leaving behind the sclera. So you have evisceration, enucleation, exenteration. So the question was more about the indications of evisceration. So let us look at that. Evisceration indications are panophthalmitis, expulsive choroidal hemorrhage, bleeding anterior cephaloma. Three things you have to write, guys. Panophthalmitis, everything is almost gone, but still they are doing evisceration. Expulsive choroidal hemorrhage, bleeding anterior cephaloma. These are the indications. You should know these, guys. This is important for the ophthalmology theory exam. Okay. Now let's move on to the next set of important questions in ophthalmology. Let's see, people, shall we move on? Very good. Next, we are moving on to lens, guys. Lens, let us look at the important topics. Congenital cataract, senile immature cataract, complicated cataract, phacoemulsification, hyphema, after cataract, posterior capsule opacity. Let's look at congenital cataract. Congenital cataract, guys, you should know that is we have capsular cataract, polar cataract. Congenital nuclear cataracts, very important, you should know, are cataracta centralis pulverenta. That is, it is affecting the embryonic nucleus. Then you have lamellar cataract or zonular cataract, which is affecting the fetal nucleus, rider, spokes of wheel, all that you have, remember. Then you have coralliform cataract, then you have in generalized cataract, you should know, coronary cataract, blue dot cataract, punctate cataract, which is the most common, but there is not much loss of vision. Okay, this can be there in Down syndrome. Okay, blue dot cataract. Then you have total congenital cataract, like in metanal, rubella. Okay, pearly white nuclear cataract, that is. So many congenital cataracts, you should know the classification, etc. So remember, what and all will you say if congenital cataract? You will say capsular, polar, nuclear, generalized. Four things you have to see. So let us look at the images. We have seen all this pulveru, lint. Then we have seen zonular. Two rings will be there, right? Two concentric rings. Then this one is what? Coralliform. This one is anterior axial embryonic sutural cataract. This is coronary cataract. Punctate blue dot cataract. So that covers congenital. Let's move on to senile cataract, guys. Senile cataract. Cataract comes under acquired age related. So you have nuclear and cortical. Nuclear will be hard. Cortical is called a soft. Now, coming to why it happens, nuclei, there'll be degeneration, nuclear sclerosis, dehydration, etc. Cortical, you have, there are, they have explained this, right? There are less pumps, so the lens gets hydrated, right? And then there is decrease in amino acids, so protein synthesis will reduce, so there is no new lens fibers. So existing lens proteins are getting denatured, right? And opacification of the lens happens. So you have to explain the mechanism, then the pumps, etc. Senile cataract, nuclear means you have some brown, black, red, etc. Remember, and these people will have second sight because of the increasing index of the lens. They will start seeing even near things. So the presbyopia, which they got at 40 years, will go away now. So it's called a second vision, second sight. So this word is important: second sight, second vision, and nuclear cataract. And nuclear senile cataract, remember, they can see better in the night. So that is what is strange about nuclear senile cataract, any nuclear cataract for that matter. So nuclear cataract, this is brown, black, red, cataracta rubra, cataracta brucens, cataracta nigra. So grading they have, based on the color, they have the grading 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 is the ultra hard, blackish, it is ultra hard, 5. Cortical senile cataract, guys, now we finished nuclear. Now cortical, you have lamellar separation, incipient, in that you have cuneiform, cupuliform. Immature again, you can see better the cuneiform and cupuliform. It is called as intumescent, swollen lens. It will be right here, grayish white lens. You can see grayish white lens here. Iris shadow, you can see red fundal glow is there till here. After this, you can see there is no red glow. Till here, you can see red glow. Iris shadow comes under immature. Then you have mature or ripe. Here you will see pearly white, right? And what else you will see here? As in, the vision is going on reducing, you can see. Slowly by mature, he is just light positive kind of a thing. Hand movement positive, light positive vision he has. Then you have hypermature, where he can just perceive light, that's it. The hypermature, you have two types, Morganian and sclerotic. In Morganian, the nucleus has sunk in the liquid cortex, remember that. So then what about sclerotic? Dirty white it will be, okay? And the pupil also will be dirty white. Here you will have shrunken cataractous lens. Here it will be shrunken lens. Remember, it is a smaller lens and thick anterior capsule. So in sclerotic, it will be smaller lens. So that is senile cortical cataract. So in spotters, let's say they give you this. What do you see? Wedge-shaped characters here. So this is cuneiform type of cataract. Cortical cataract, then they can give you this. They can ask you, what is this? This is immature, gray. Immature senile cortical cataract. This is pearly white, mature. Then this is Morganian. You can see that the nucleus has fallen inside in milky white. Then you have same here, Morganian. You can see here, you can see anterior capsule is wrinkled. Guys, all these images they can give for spotters. This is showing iris shadow. You can see iris shadow here. This is mature. That is why you can see pearly white, mature senile cataract. This one is immature, where you should be able to see the iris shadow. That completes senile cataract. Let's look at complicated cataract. Complicated cataract is due to disease of the eye. So you can have like uveitis, glaucoma, retinitis pigmentosa, high myopia. So what will you see here? Posterior subcapsular breadcrumb appearance. So here they are showing complicated cataract with healed iridocyclitis. You can see all the irregular pupil, right? Muddy eye. Next important topic is phacoemulsification. So this is the treatment for cataract, guys. What are they doing here? So there are a lot of surgical techniques for extraction of cataract. You have intracapsular cataract extraction, extracapsular cataract extraction. Okay, in that you have phacoemulsification. So in this video, we have to look at phacoemulsification as an important topic for the exam. So what are they doing here? The nucleus is emulsified and aspirated with probe. What about the cortex? So this is very, very advantageous because it doesn't have suture. Sutureless surgery, it will become early visual rehabilitation and less astigmatism. All these 3 points you have to write if they ask you phacoemulsification. So what are the merits? Topical anesthesia, post-operative congestion is minimal, small incision, less corneal complications, visual rehabilitation is quicker. Demerits are also there, like the skill of the surgeon should be very good and they should have very high machinery, high cost machinery should be there. A lot of limitations are also there, because if it is a very hard cataract, it will be very hard, okay? Machine dependent. This is a machine dependent. Then what else? How do they do it? Procedure. So they can ask you, what are they doing here? So they are removing the capsule, they are going inside and putting some hydro separation. This is hydro separation, right? Yeah, hydro dissection. This is hydro delineation. Then they are doing nucleus emulsification by divide and conquer technique. Four quadrant. See, they made it four quadrant. And then here, aspiration, they are aspiring the cortex. Yeah, see, so that is what is answering our question on the cortex. So cortex, they are aspiring. Implantation of a foldable IOL. So they are putting a foldable IOL. Hyphema, guys, is blood in anterior chamber. Just remember that there is some grading here. 1, 2, 3, 4, something. If it is greater than 50%, it is becoming 3. And if it is 100%, it is 4. Okay. Another important topic is after cataract. Guys, so please pay attention to this. This is also called a secondary cataract. So when do people get it? After the cataract surgery. So what is happening here? Residual, some opaque lens matter was left off, or proliferative type of after cataract. So some residue, you only left something looks like, or proliferative, the left out anterior epithelial cells, what happens? They develop cataract. Okay. So proliferative hyaline bands may sweep across the whole posterior capsule. So from anterior looks like posterior is also affected. So this is mainly posterior. You should know posterior capsule opacification, PCO. So what and all you should know here? These things. Dense membranous Sommer ring Elchnick pearls. All these are the types of after cataract. Which are the three types of after cataract? Dense membranous, Sommer rings ring. Oh, there are two rings here. Sommer rings rings and Elchnick pearls. Okay. Okay. Then how do you treat this? YAG laser capsulotomy. Very important. ND-YAG laser you should remember. Then if it is dense, then surgical membranectomy. You saw that, right? Dense membrane, surgical membranectomy. By surgery, they will remove. Sommer ring, no treatment. If the central part is clear, then no treatment is, because you saw Sommer ring's ring is kind of outside. Elchnick pearls, again, YAG laser only, capsulotomy. Fine. So if there's membrane only, they're doing surgery. Otherwise, everything by laser, they seem to be managing. Guys, now let us move on to glaucoma. Important topics here. Open angle glaucoma. Primary open angle glaucoma. So it is also called as chronic simple glaucoma of adult onset. Risk factors and all. There's a lot in this. So what is glaucoma? Optic neuropathy, irreversible visual field defects can be associated with raised intraocular pressure. So the rate of production of aqueous humor, 2.3 microliter per minute. Normal or low tension glaucoma is when there is no raised intraocular pressure. Ocular hypertension means intraocular pressure is raised, everything else is fine. Cause of global blindness, glaucoma is the second leading cause. So you have primary and secondary. In primary, you have this open angle, and then you have here open angle and angle closure. So adult one. Congenital, you have congenital, leave that. Adult, in the adult one, you have open angle and angle closure, as you have seen. So, everything we have seen, right? So, basically here what it is a slow progressive problem, normal angle, but there will be visual field defects because of this raised intraocular pressure, isn't it? Have they mentioned here? Yeah, slow progressive, greater than 21 millimeter mercury. So, predisposing and risk factors we have seen, then we have seen pathogenesis, why, what exactly is happening. The trabecular meshwork stiffening, the pumps are not working, looks like the trabecular meshwork sclerosis thickening, right? Narrowing of the intratrabecular spaces, deposition of amorphous material, collapse of Schlemm's canal. So all these causes, they don't know, it could be immunogenic. Then they're talking why optic nerve should get affected. So mechanical pressure, vascular insufficiency, secondary insults, retinal ganglion cell death, right? Apoptosis. Clinical features, what they'll have asymptomatic, or they can have headaches, scotomas, they will have, then difficulty in doing close work, frequent changes of presbyopic glasses, very important, delayed dark adaption, blindness. So you can see here, tunnel vision. So they will have anterior segment signs. What will be the signs? You will see normal anterior segment. See, their angle is open, right? So you will see low central corneal thickness, pupillary reflex is sluggish. Then you will see this intraocular pressure changes during the day, diurnal variation test. Optic disc changes, you will see what and all. Yes, how's it going? Is it becoming too much? Yes, focus here. We will finish. These are very important topics for your ophthalmology theory exam. So we're just revising. Optic disc, you will see vertically oval cup, asymmetry between the two cups, right, of the two eyes. Large cup, you will have splinter hemorrhages. Then you will have atrophy of the retinal nerve fiber layer. Then you will see marked cupping. Cupping is going on increasing, right? Then you will see thinning of the neuroretinal rim, notching. Isn't rule. This isn't rule is a good thing, but it won't be followed. It should have isn't rule, but it won't follow isn't rule now. Nasal shifting of retinal vessels, then bayonet signing, pulsation of the retinal arterioles. This pulsation is a pathognomic sign of glaucoma. Lamellar dot sign in the pores of lamina cribrosa. Optic atrophy, guys. Now we have reached optic atrophy. Then visual field defects. What and all visual field defects will be there? You already know this. You will have isopter contraction, barring of blind spot, then small winged paracentral scotoma, then sidal scotoma. This paracentral scotoma will join with the blind spot, right? That is the sidal scotoma. It looks like sickle shape, right? This one, guys. So you have then arcuate of or Jerem's scotoma. Then a double ring, ring or double arcuate scotoma, Ronnie's central nasal step, peripheral field defects. So you have all this. Finally, the person will go into tubular vision, tunnel vision, temporal island may still be there of vision. So how are they checking? Some Humphreys field analyzer to check the visual field. Severity of glaucoma is there, mild, moderate, severe. Then tonometry, they are doing investigations. Diagnosis, all this we have already seen, right? Management, how will you manage? You should remember some drugs. Which are the drugs you will know? Latanoprost, bimatoprost. Under prostaglandins, you should know that. Under beta blockers, you should know like betoxolol, levobunolol. Then you should know carbonic anhydrase inhibitors like dorzolamide and brinzolamide. This much you should know. Then you should know mannitol. That's also important. Okay. Then laser trabeculoplasty they are doing. Then what else are they talking about? Selective laser trabeculoplasty, where only the pigmented trabecular meshwork they are targeting. What else are they saying? Guys, is it going too much? So these are all very important topics. You have to know these, guys. It's no option. So you have trabeculectomy, fistulizing or filtration surgery. So all that we have seen in primary open angle glaucoma. What about secondary angle closure glaucoma? Mechanism of narrow angle acute congestive glaucoma. You should know all this. Differences. So primary angle closure, guys, you have classification. Primary angle closure suspect, primary angular closure suspect plus high intraocular pressure, primary angle closure glaucoma. So under primary angle closure, you have so many things, and the final one you have the glaucoma. Okay. So you have some prone dark room test, then you have some Vogt's triad in case they have ever had an attack of acute primary angle closure. So they will have glaucum flecken, that is anterior subcapsular lenticular opacity that they are showing here. Glaucum flecken because of glaucoma attack previously, iris atrophy you can see here, and then non-reacting slightly dilated pupil. Precipitating factors for attack of acute congestive glaucoma, dim illumination, emotional stress, anxiety, excitement, use of mydriatics. Okay. Last thing they can ask you in glaucoma as in high priority is buphthalmos in congenital glaucoma. Buphthalmos can happen because of many things. But remember, if they ask you buphthalmos or congenital glaucoma, what to write? So buphthalmos is bull's eye. When will you see it in congenital glaucoma, what happened to me, or developmental glaucoma? So basically, what is buphthalmos? Eyeball enlarges. Remember, eyeball enlarges, becomes more than 13 millimeter before the age of 3 years. Okay, that is the glaucoma. Children developing congenital glaucoma at early age, that they are considering less than 3 years. So under congenital glaucoma, you have newborn glaucoma, infantile and juvenile glaucoma. So cornea is enlarged, you know, and there is this decimate stare. So Hab's striae you should see. Where is Hab's striae? Do you have a photo? So you should be able to see some lines here. Okay. Then large cornea, should be differentiated from megalocornea. Then these people can have blue sclera also, right? How will you treat primary congenital glaucoma? Incisional angle surgery, goniotomy, trabeculotomy. Then what else is there? Goniotomy, trabeculotomy, trabeculectomy, combined trabeculotomy with trabeculectomy. Trabeculotomy is what and trabeculectomy is what? Lectomy is filtration, that you're making an other path or something, right? Fistulation surgery. Trabeculotomy is making holes in the existing thing, something like that. Okay. Glaucoma drainage devices in incalcitrant cases. Incalcitrant means what? What is the meaning? Stubborn cases. So in glaucoma, this much is important, guys. These three topics are important. Then coming to vitreous astroid hyalosis is a very important topic. Remember, this is calcium containing lipids. White rounded bodies, where in the vitreous gel, remember, okay, white rounded bodies in vitreous gel, these are formed because of accumulation of calcium containing lipids. Calcium, CA, remember, calcium, don't forget, calcium containing lipids. Remember, this is unilateral, it will be there only in one eye's vitreous gel. It is asymptomatic, usually doesn't affect people. Old patients, general relationship with diabetes and hypercholesterolemia, cholesterolemia, cholesterolemia. This is vitreous opacity, remember, okay. They can also ask in the exam this one, synchysis scintillans. This is cholesterosis bulbi. This is cholesterol. But here it is calcium containing lipid. But these people can have hypercholesterolemia also.